So we will turn our attention now from the questions of technology and power that animated our morning discussions to those of the refugee crisis in Europe. And to moderate our discussion and introduce our panelists, and I'd ask the panel to please come up onto the stage, is someone who I am very lucky to share a title with, and that title is Richard Perry Professor. It is a title I wear with distinction, and I know that John Jackson, the Dean of the School of Social Policy and Practice, himself an important scholar of social movements and an inspirational leader for that school, is also the Richard Perry Professor, and I could think of no one better to moderate this conversation than John Jackson. Dean Jackson, thank you.
It is my pleasure to serve as one small part of what I think is an incredible series of events over the next couple of days to inaugurate this incredibly important center here at the University of Pennsylvania. I am the Dean of the School of Social Policy and Practice. I'm also the Richard Perry University Professor and have felt so honored to be able to imagine myself as part of what is an incredibly exciting and vibrant intellectual community here at the University of Pennsylvania. One of the things I want to let you know to begin with is we are really invested in the idea of making sure this is a dialogue. So what I'll try to do is I'll try to offer up some questions, some opening questions for each one of our panelists. We'll maybe go back and forth a little bit, trying to keep them relatively brief, and then eventually open up to the audience for maybe 15 minutes or so of a larger discussion with the entire group. And so to begin with, I want to let you know every one of our panelists has a bio that you have in your program, so I'm just going to do a very short and truncated version of an introduction just so we can get the ball rolling, give you a chance to applaud them for being here and bringing their expertise and their background to this conversation. And then we can really begin to engage this question of how Europe and European democracies can engage and deal with this question of a growing global refugee issue. The first person I'd like to introduce really quickly is someone who is actually stepping in relatively late in the game for one of his colleagues who was supposed to be here and couldn't make it. So the first panelist is Nidal Batari, who is a DC-based Palestinian refugee in Syria, who's the senior program manager at the People Demand Change organization. So thank you for coming, Nidal. We also have Kathleen Newland, who is senior fellow and co-founder of Migration Policy Institute. Kathleen, thank you for being here. We have our colleague, Eric Schwartz, who's dean of the Humphrey School of Public Affairs at the University of Minnesota, and was Assistant Secretary of State for Population, Refugees, and Migration from 2009 to 2011. Thank you for being here, too. And finally, at the far end is Catherine Vindertal Devenden, who's Director of Research at the National Center for Social Research in the French Ministry of Education and Research, and we're glad you're here. So thank you all for being here. Thank you, Kathy. And what I thought I'd do maybe is start with Eric. Not just because he's an academic and we often like talking to one another and have to warm up to talk to other people afterwards, but also because we're based here in the University at the University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia in the US, and one of the questions I guess it begs is whether or not there's anything that the US experience can bring to a conversation about what's going on in Europe. Are there any lessons that might be learned as a function of how the US has dealt with similar kinds of questions about refugee flows? And so maybe we'll begin there. If there are lessons, what are they? And what does and does not resonate with the kinds of things you see going on across the Atlantic?
Well, first, thank you so much for the opportunity to be here. It's great to be in Philadelphia, and it's great to be in this wonderful institution. I'm also told that I have 7 minutes, so you can judge me by that. In Minnesota, we're very punctual, so if you don't meet that requirement, you get in trouble. I also appreciate, I'm not using my 7 minutes yet, but I also appreciate the comment that, you know, that I'm an academic. Of course, I spent my life, most of my professional life in the field of practice. And if you told my faculty at the Humphrey School that I'm an academic, I might get run out of town on a rail. So, but I appreciate that. I am a tenured professor at the University of Minnesota, for the record. So let me start with the operational issues, or the more sort of programmatic answer to your question, and then move to the broader and, frankly, the more important issues. There are two ways that that refugees, people who fear persecution, or in common, or more and more people who are fleeing violence in the world, get to Europe and the United States. They get there in unplanned ways, those who are crossing borders and requesting asylum, and they get there in a more programmed, discretionary program effort in which governments make determinations every year about how many of those who are fleeing violence and persecution they're prepared to accept as refugees. And to my mind, what Europe is dealing with now is really the first challenge, which is the much more difficult one. And we have the same challenge, and we don't deal with it particularly well. But it seems to me if there are lessons that we can offer to Europe on the program level, it really comes from that other program, the Refugee Resettlement Program, and the model that was established in the 1980 Refugee Act, when we, as a country, as a government, as a Congress, decided that we were going to regularize a process whereby we decide every year how many refugees are coming into the United States. And what we can learn there, what we can offer Europe programmatically, I think, are, and that's a program that involves the State Department, the Department of Health and Human Services, and its Office of Refugee Resettlement. And I think there are two, in my experience, there are two lessons that we could probably be helpful to Europeans on with respect to this program. Number one is the fact that this is a program that is a public-private partnership that engages private non-governmental sector throughout our country. Almost every single state has a refugee coordinator and a network of non-governmental organizations. And that's important in terms of creating a reservoir, or the possibility of a reservoir of support for refugees in any country. And I think there's more that we can do with respect to that partnership, and I think we have lessons to offer to Europe. The second point I would make, although I think we resettle refugees too much on the cheap, that program is, it focuses on self-sufficiency, and it's frankly less expensive than some of the European refugee resettlement programs. And although I think we need to be providing more support, I think there's a middle ground that offers European governments who are thinking, you know, about the cost of resettlement. It offers some options, this priority that we place in this program towards self-sufficiency. So that's the programmatic. But that addresses some of the programmatic issues. To me, the more significant question is world leadership. We can't serve as models for Europe if European leaders and European publics don't recognize us as leaders. If we're not prepared to practice at home what we preach abroad, and if we're not prepared to set an example, and there I think the challenge for us is significant and substantial. I only have about 3 minutes left, so I'm going to give you the Reader's Digest version of this part of my remarks. But essentially, I think we need to be doing more in terms of addressing the challenges in Syria, the root causes of much of the refugee flight in the world. I think what President Obama is, and there's some progress on that score, I think what President Obama is doing with respect to the Leaders Summit that will take place tomorrow, the summit that the U.S. has convened on refugees in New York, is a good move because it's he is putting a focus on support for host nations that are receiving refugees, increased education and training for refugees, increased resettlement, and putting a little bit of skin in the game by increasing our own refugee resettlement numbers for next year. I think the U.S. needs to be doing more to call out the demagoguery that we're seeing increasingly in Europe. I think the United States, I think people listen to the President of the United States, and I think he needs to be doing more. But I also think that we're in a major test here. We have a major presidential candidate who is talking about putting up walls, keeping out Muslims. This is nothing completely new in our tradition, whether it's our original sin of slavery, whether it's anti-immigrant sentiment of the know-nothings in the mid-19th century, anti-Semitic rants from Charles Edward Coughlin in the early part of this century. He had tens of millions of followers, of supporters. So this kind of intolerance, this kind of appeal to our fears rather than our hopes and aspirations is nothing new, but I do think we're at a critical moment. But I also am optimistic, because while I can't discount the possibility of a victory, of an electoral victory by a candidate who has, to my mind, promoted intolerance, I think the demographics in this country are on our side. And I think there are forces at play that are bigger than any particular presidential election that will inevitably move us toward a more inclusive society. There will be fits and starts and upsets, but I think that gives us in the United States a unique capacity to serve as a model of inclusion and diversity, not only for the rest of the world, but certainly for our European friends and allies.
Thank you, Eric. I appreciate it. Catherine, a couple of notes that Eric used to frame his discussion I want to maybe use to offer up a question to you. So the first one is, clearly one of the backdrops for this discussion is the growing public, I would say, conflagration around debates about what to do with refugees, immigrants, foreigners. There's all of this discourse that may or may not be constructively unfurling in the public sphere. As someone who's been studying international migration for decades, is there anything new in the trends you're seeing now in Europe that we haven't quite seen before? So what are they? If not, tell me why the discourse seems to be shifting so.
To me or for the other one?
For
because
for you,
we are both.
Oh, yeah. for you.
Thank you. I am very pleased to be here, and thanks to the Perry World House to invite me to this opening session. And so I shall say that the situation is not so new, because the crisis is partly constructed by the public opinion, by the European states, because in the 1990s, Europe received 500,000 asylum seekers. Most of them arrived in Germany, because it was at the border of the former Europe, in Austria, in some other countries, but for the most countries now, because we received in 2015 1.2 million new asylum seekers, most of countries involved were southern European countries, because they are close to the places of conflicts, to the places of arrival, with mixed flows, most of them refugees, but also people asking for work. Now it is Italy and Greece that have been mostly involved in the crisis. So it is not so new. But what has been new is that we have shifted in Europe from a humanitarian approach to refugees to security approaches, mostly. And the crisis has been constructed because there is a crisis, but not necessarily in the refugee question, because we have a long tradition of refugees during all the former century, but there is a crisis of labor, a crisis of a political crisis about the other, and also the difficulty of most European countries to have a common approach and to have a solidarity answer. I should say that except for Germany, which received 1 million newcomers, not only refugees, last year, 600,000 asylum seekers, the other European countries did not receive so many asylum seekers. In France, for example, we had in 2014 60,000 asylum seekers, and last year 80,000 asylum seekers. So it is not so much. So there has been a construction of the approach of invaded Europe by refugees. And I should say that answering to the question, democracy, when it is manipulated by some political parties, by some public opinion polls and so on, can be an obstacle to the solution of refugee crisis, because most of the crisis has been made by the political debate, and most of the crisis in most European countries, there was not crisis. Another aspect has been the a kind of divide, a gap between Western European countries, which said more or less, yes, we will accept the program of Mr. Juncker about sharing, burden sharing, the newcomers, and the Eastern European countries, which said no, because they said our identity can be challenged by these newcomers. Most of these countries are involved in very strong extreme righties political trends. We have also to notice that. There has been also a crisis of dissuasion. We were speaking before about the technologies in the protection approach of the countries, of democracies, but also most of our 30 years of dissuasion have collapsed. With these arrivals, not only last year, but the years before, with the arrival of refugees. So, crisis of dissuasion, crisis of solidarity, but finally, the crisis is not so new because it has been partly made by the public opinion. And I shall finish by saying that. We can Europe and the US are the first destination for migration flows in the world. We have to try to share experiences together, but the specificity of Europe is that it is very close to many conflicts in the south and in the near and far east, and so we are directly involved with the question of reception and finding a solution to these newcomers. There would be solutions, but they have not been proposed, like temporary protection, like possibilities to open more the labor market, like possibilities to also to give more refugee statuses. But the climate of frilosity in which we are involved in Europe is a very important obstacle to implement those policies.
Thank you, Catherine. Kathleen, in Catherine's answer, she brought up figures from several specific European nations. You've recently completed a study on Turkey's refugee policy. And I wanted to ask you a question maybe coming out of that research. And the question simply is, how does the EU-Turkey deal, and you can maybe describe some of what that entails in your response if you like, how does that deal on the refugee issue play into the political debate on both sides of the Aegean? That is to say, is it helping to cool off some of the anti-refugee rhetoric and backlash, or fanning the flames even further, or none of those two?
Thank you, John. I think It's really, it's such a pleasure to be here. It's a very exciting occasion, spectacular building, and obviously a very enthusiastic crowd. So thank you, for inviting me. And yes, I've been spending quite a bit of time in Turkey this past year. And it's what Turkey's welcome to Syrian refugees has really been quite stunning. It's a period right now when it's kind of hard to say nice things about Turkey because they're going through such political turmoil and such a crackdown by an increasingly authoritarian president. But they have absorbed getting on toward 3 million Syrian refugees, or 3 million refugees, almost all of whom are Syrian. There are about maybe 250,000, 300,000 from other countries. But it's remarkable, and they have been welcomed. They've been one of President Erdogan's causes. I think he's seen them as a way of increasing Turkey's soft power, asserting its role as a regional power, maybe even a great power. He would like to see that trajectory, and also a sort of tool in a rather personal feud between him and President Assad. So Turkey really holds the key to the European crisis in many ways, since the huge ramp up of numbers in 2015. And I think the answer to your question is yes. The European deal with Turkey has cooled off the situation quite a bit. In practical terms, I think the closing of the Balkan routes, with successive Balkan countries closing their doors to Syrian refugees trying to move north from Greece up to Germany and Sweden primarily, that's probably had more influence on the actual numbers. But the fact that European politicians, and Angela Merkel particularly, in fact, other European politicians were quite irritated with her for what they saw as sort of freelancing on a deal with Turkey without a great deal of consultation. But there was real panic about this sort of seemingly uncontrolled flow. So the deal that was arrived at last autumn has sort of four major components, if I can describe them briefly. The main one affecting the European refugee situation is that people who are asylum seekers who arrive without authorization in Europe, primarily in Greece, from Turkey, will be returned to Turkey if they don't claim asylum or if their asylum claims are denied, up to 72,000 people. Well, for Turkey, this is kind of a drop in the bucket, really, but for Europe, it's symbolically at least very important. Not many people have actually been returned. The first group was a couple of dozen Pakistani people who are judged to be migrants rather than refugees. And the second part of that arrangement is that for each person returned from Europe to Turkey, Europe will accept one Syrian refugee. So it's sort of one in, not a refugee, and one out from as far as Turkey is concerned. The Europeans agreed to give 3 billion euros to Turkey to help with the support for the refugees there. And that's important to Turkey because up until now, Turkey has received very little international assistance to deal with this huge load of refugees, at least in comparative terms. You know, Jordan, Lebanon have much higher per capita ratios of refugees. They're much poorer countries. And Turkey, at the beginning of this crisis, was kind of, we can handle this. We don't need your help. We're Turkey. We're great. So donors turned to other countries that were very welcoming of assistance. Two others, the sort of quid pro quo, two elements of quid pro quo for this is an agreement that Europe would take a very serious look at granting visa-free travel to Turkish citizens to Europe. It's very important for the Turks' sense of themselves as Europeans. Turkey has to meet a whole list of conditions to make that happen, but it seems to be progressing. And most importantly, but also most distant, least likely to happen, is the reopening of EU accession talks with Turkey. So the numbers in themselves are not so critical, but I think the sort of symbolic importance of this deal, that European leaders are seen to be getting a grip on the situation, and in Germany in particular, you know, Angela Merkel has just lost Berlin, her party has just lost Berlin this past weekend. They lost the election in the state where her own constituency resides. Now, these, turning to this question of democracy in Europe, these losses to the Christian Democratic Party have not gone exclusively to the far right. They've gone to the Green Party, they've gone to the Liberal Party, they've gone to the SDP, the Merkel's coalition partner. But alternatives for Germany, the right-wing party is now represented in several state governments. Democracy at work. That in many Eastern European countries is, I'm afraid, what we're seeing.
Thank you, by the way, Kathleen. And in some ways, maybe it makes me feel like, Nidal, one of the questions to ask you is one about the difference between policy around these issues, the deals that can be made or not, and the larger politicization of the refugee crisis mm-hmm. in all of these domestic locales and all these nation states that have all these implications for elected office, for the kinds of decisions the electorate's making about who should run the country. How do you explain or try to understand this hyper-politicization of the refugee issue? What is that a function of? How should we make sense of it? Is there anything that can be done to push back against the ways in which it gets manipulated in some of the public discourse?
Thank you so much for inviting me. And actually, this is a key question. It seems like we were living in a broken system already. Like the United Nations system for refugees is broken. The European system for hosting refugees is broken. And obviously, the system here in the US for hosting refugees also is broken. So in total, what happened, I think that the Syrian crisis is just uncovered this broken system. This started maybe with the Iraqi refugees and Pakistani and Afghani refugees who are a big part of refugees who are trying to reach Europe today also. Maybe the Syrian refugees is the biggest amount of them. But why it was politicized, it's just if UNHCR says that we are seeing the worst crisis since World War II, it's just because we have seen the worst response in history to this crisis in Syria. On many levels, the first level, the logistical level, which starts with the hosting, sheltering, housing, and then healthcare, and then to resettlement, and then to deal with the trauma of this. Actually, we haven't seen any steps of these steps, regular steps, that should be implemented with any refugee crisis in Syria. We haven't seen it at all. This led to the second crisis, is the lack of coordination. Actually, not the lack of coordination, maybe the coordination, the Syrian crisis, is in the zero level. OCHA, UN OCHA, it tried in the past, in the last 5 years, to coordinate with the Europeans, with Turks, Lebanese, and Jordanians regarding the refugee crisis, and they couldn't. This led to a chaos. And I don't know if you have an idea that more than 1,500,000 refugees, regardless of the Palestinian refugees, were living inside Syria. Iraqi refugees, Afghani refugees, and from other, and Sudanese, Somali, from mm-hmm. Somal, all these people fled to Lebanon, to Jordan, and or moved to Turkey, and all of them are trying to reach Europe. Now, why Europe? Actually, to be just to make everything clear, there is a crisis, a refugee crisis around the world. It's not only in Europe. And maybe it's bigger in other countries, like in Turkey, like in Pakistan, and other countries. But in Europe, maybe because everybody is trying to reach Europe because it's like a dreamland for everybody in this situation. In this chaos and with the rise of the extremism and Islamic State and the other, and Jabhat Nusra and other factions, Islamic factions and extremism in the region, like, there, I don't believe that the European governments were ready to take a right decision whether they should host or should not. So instead of dealing with this crisis as a humanitarian crisis, it turned to be, as Kathleen mentioned, a security, national security crisis. And when you are dealing with a national security crisis, you are taking political decisions. And it was clear in 2015 when the European Union, I think in April 2015, they declared the refugee agenda. They prioritized their response in two main fields or topics. The first one is how is to save the lives of people who are trying to flee from the Middle East. And the second one is how to control the flow of refugees. I mean, they are, and this is the second one, is the midterm and the long-term goal for the European Union. I mean, they are the goal of the European Union is to deal with the flow of refugees, not with the existence of these refugees on their lands. And secondly, and I want to close here, it seems like we are seeing the rise of the right wing in Europe right now, like, as Catherine mentioned, in Germany, but we've seen right wing is winning in Poland, for example, and the People's Party in Denmark is like putting a very sectarian and racist policy towards the refugees, and just today the leader of the party was describing these refugees of like thieves, rapists, and all these descriptions. And I don't know if we can talk about the European Union now, especially after the withdrawal of the UK. And I feel like there are a lot of indicators that says that the European Union itself is living a very critical moment now. Should it stay as a union? I don't know, actually. Mm-hmm. But I mean, there are a lot of challenges for these Europeans, for saving the European Union and for saving their constitutions, because dealing in another way, like sending back refugees, will break their constitutions. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if these countries is ready now to break or change their constitution.
Thank you, Nizam. That was helpful. It makes me think maybe of going back, Catherine, to a point that you touched on earlier to see if you can elaborate a little bit more. And it's a question both about whether or not you can give us a sense of which nations in Europe you feel like are doing a better job. I know they're dealing with different magnitudes, different scales of the issue, doing a better job managing not just policy around this, but the politics of this mm-hmm. stuff. And then how would you assess the European, going back to Ndal's point, the European Union's approach to this entire issue? How would you describe it, characterize it? Have they been able to respond in a way that actually makes sense and that allows the European Union to serve as a kind of powerful bulwark against some of maybe the more dysfunctional and non-constructive political conversations that flow out of this?
Yes, thank you for this question, which is very important. Europe is paying the weakness of its political answer to migration in general, including refugee, because the specificity of Europe compared with the United States is that Europe has difficulties to accept itself as a continent of immigration. Because in the past, in the long past, it was mostly a continent of emigration. Europeans were many to go to the US, to Canada, to Australia, to the colonies, and so on. So since mid-1960s and 1970s, it became progressively an immigration continent, and the European identity, national nation-state identities are not built on that. So the response are short-term immigration for work and not building our identity, including migration and refugees. I think this is very important to understand the importance, as you mentioned, of the extreme right stressing on the question of immigration in European countries. And this this very weak answer has consisted mostly now to ask to Turkey, which is very strange. Turkey is not member of the European Union, and Europe asked to Turkey to solve the refugee question. It is a very strange answer. And in the past, it was mostly Libya. Libya had a lot of bilateral and multilateral agreements with European countries, mostly France and Italy, because they are close, to manage the arrival of refugees from and also newcomers as workers from especially African countries. And in exchange, Libya was accepting policies of development of, and many other parcels to the president. And now that Libya has collapsed, we ask to Turkey to do the job. So it is very strange. It is a kind of delegation of policy from Europe to other countries, because European countries don't want to be really involved in giving an answer to the question. Europe has to apply the treaties it has signed. We have signed the Geneva Convention. We have signed the Convention of 1990 of the rights of all migrant workers and their family. We have signed the Convention of the rights of the children, because we have more and more unaccompanied children among these refugees. So first we have to apply this convention and not to have a gap, as you said, between the rule and the implementation. And Europe could also apply other forms of protections which were made for the Yugoslavian crisis, like the temporary protection for those who do not enter in the definition we have now about who is a refugee. Second, we have also to open, perhaps paradoxically, more the legal labor market, because we are not only facing with Middle East and Near East refugees, but with some African countries, people who are both. They are not unfunded to ask for refugee, because in some countries it is very difficult to build a future, but in the same time they mostly ask for jobs, and it is the job, the access to job for non-Europeans is very difficult to have legally, because there are protections for European workers. And after the last point, which could be also implemented, would be to allow forms of mobility for those who have multiple visa entrances and so on. If we allow to more people to be more mobile, the crisis of refugees will not be a crisis. It will be the implementation of the Geneva Convention, as we had with the Vietnamese, with the people from Chile in the 1970s and so on. So the crisis is mostly built with the crisis of migration at all.
Thank you, Catherine. Thinking about, again, I'm going to go back to you, Eric, the ways in which a discussion about refugee resettlement is linked to much larger fears, concerns, that are stoked in various ways, and that in some ways doesn't always, as Kathleen says, doesn't always have to translate to people gravitating towards the far right in terms of thinking about protecting the sanctity of the borders of the nation state. But I do want to ask you, are there ways in which you can give us a better sense of what the context is for these discussions specifically about a refugee crisis that speak to larger concerns about national autonomy, to questions of sovereignty, and to issues about the place of the nation state in the larger global universe in the 21st century?
Your question gives me the opportunity to offer an answer that I think both responds to the points that Catherine makes and addresses some of the issues that you've raised. Catherine's talking about norms that govern behavior, that should govern behavior, international norms that should govern behavior. She's also talking about some policy options that you could implement as a government that are consistent with those norms. I'm the dean of a policy school, and so in a policy school, we try to think about, okay, so how do we get there? If we could snap our fingers and achieve those, implement those actions based on those norms, then we wouldn't need this event. I would say that the politics that are creating obstacles to those kinds of outcomes are the outgrowth of significant and substantial changes that are not simply the product of the imagination of intolerant politicians. More than a million people migrated into Europe in 2015. That's a big deal. That is a huge deal, and that's not what happened in the decade before 2015. And it has changed the reality on the ground for many Europeans. With the destruction of ISIS or the destruction of the caliphate, there may well be, some say there is likely to be, an increase in political violence in Europe, because those thousands and thousands of fighters, they're not all going to be killed, right? They're going to go somewhere, right? And this creates real issues. And the question is, how do politicians and public officials manage that change, right? And to my mind, I think there are actions that leaders need to be taking now so that it's more easy to implement the kind of measures to which Catherine's alluding. And I would say, number one, I would turn again to the United States. I think we need to exercise greater leadership in a range of ways, including dealing with the root causes of this, you know, if not unprecedented, really significant and substantial forced migration, the likes of which we haven't seen in decades. Secondly, I think the European governments and European leaders need to be moving towards developing the institutional capacity to manage this within their own countries. That's what leaders have to do, because if you have capability, then it's easier to exercise political will. If European populations see that the governments kind of can manage it, then the level of fear and uncertainty will go down. I think we have to sustain the dialogue with Turkey. And I think migration management, and I know for an advocate, for a human rights advocate, refugee advocate, the term migration management sort of makes you cringe. But I think migration management has got to be part of this as well, arrangements with governments like Turkey. And so, in other words, I think political leaders have to think about measures that they need to take that recognizes the new global realities and adjust to them so that implementation of policies of inclusion and respect for diversity become easier politically. Because if they're not easier politically, they're not going to get implemented and nothing's going to happen.
Thank you, Eric. That's helpful. And maybe what I'll do before I open it up to the audience is ask Kathleen and Nadal to maybe speak to the very issue that you bring up, which is to try to explain to us, help us understand how to make sure we recognize what Eric called the real issues, right? The facts on the ground about changes in migratory patterns and the like, from the sort of phantasmagoric fears and anxieties and concerns that don't always map easily just onto the facts of the matter. So can you give us a sense, both of you all, of how we might do a better job of linking the evidence, the specificities of these migratory changes to the kind of, you know, the ability of the electorate and of the citizenry to run with facts in directions that the facts really don't necessarily always have to take them? How do we reconcile those two issues? The issue of, you know, making sure we're figuring out ways to actually understand changes going on the planet that have implications for all of us, and doing it in a manner that allows people not to be histrionic about it, not to be hyperbolic about it, and to respond in a rational and constructive way about trying to engage and deal with these important global changes.
Actually, to be honest with you, as much as it seems like very complicated, especially the situation in the Middle East and this whole crisis of ISIS and Jabhat Nusra and refugees, and to the extent that you feel that you are remapping the whole world again between a new East and the new West, as much as sometimes you feel like it's, no, there is a solution, but a solution with a price. Talking about Turkey, it seems like Turkey has taken a very hard decision and a very strong decision to solve a lot of these problems. But the price is really high. For example, like today or like a month ago, Turkey started military operations in northern Syria. In the last 5 years, Turkey was trying to convince Europeans and the US and Obama administration to create or to establish a safe zone area for refugees. This will stop flowing refugees from Syria to Europe. No one listened to Turkey. So Turkey today is enforcing this area. I would say Turkey is occupying northern Syria today, okay, but in order to create a safe zone that will kill the dream, of course, of having a Kurdish state in northern Syria, at the same time, they will create a safe zone for millions and millions of refugees. So, you got that?
No, thanks.
Let me make just three very quick points about the sort of the nature of the fears that people have. I think the greatest fear is fear of the unknown. And one of the things that we see in this country as well as in Europe is that antipathy toward refugees is greatest in the places where there are fewest refugees and immigrants. It's the southeast of England. It's the rural eastern Germany. It's La France profonde, you know. It's places where people have never met a refugee and don't know what they are. So it's a fear of the unknown and people who look different and sound different and eat different food. So part of the answer, I think, is a very person-to-person kind of exposure. And it's not easy to arrange, but it's not impossible. Second point is that this is much bigger than immigration. You know, the immigration is sort of the visible face of globalization. The people are afraid of losing their jobs, they're afraid of their neighborhoods changing, they're afraid of lots of big sort of inchoate things. And the refugees and immigrants are the aspect of that they can see. So that tends to be the focus. Facts don't make much difference in these arguments. These are very emotional reactions. And so I think you have to appeal to people on the level of emotion. Mm-hmm. This is why this family of five daughters came to the United States, or why they fled from Lebanon to Europe. You have to tell the personal stories. And secondly, the last point I was make is whether this whole historical episode turns out to be a disaster or a benefit for Europe particularly, which after all really needs people, depends on integration, whether integration is successful. And I think Germany is working really hard on that. The Eastern European countries are not interested. They feel like they've been pushed around for centuries by foreigners. They've been pushed around by the Ottomans and the Russians and the Habsburgs, and you know, they don't want somebody telling them who gets to live next door. The getting to know who these people are and sort of changing the narrative, I think, is really critical. Sorry to have gone on so
that's
long.
No, that's great, Kathleen. And before we open it up, maybe I'll throw out one more question for anyone who wants to answer it. And this really does pivot, I think, on the point you raise about people looking different, eating different foods. Every refugee isn't the same. And so the question I have for you is, what difference does cultural difference make? What difference does religious difference make? What difference does it make that we're talking about a very specific, at least in the contemporary European context, a specific refugee flow, as opposed to talking about refugees in more some more generic universalist register? What is it specifically that you can allow us to think about that will give us a sense of the particular challenges posed by this specific sort of flow trajectory for refugees out of Syria?
I mean, I honestly still hear Europeans talking about the near conquest of Vienna and turning back, you know, the Mongol invasion and this kind. I mean, I'm so American. This kind of stuff just astonishes me. But I think there really is a sort of sense of historical opposition that at some level, sometimes at a really gut level and sometimes at a rather subtle, subliminal political level, kind of resonates. And that, I mean, that's a recipe for disaster, I think.
Maybe this is a part, but the other part is what we see now in Europe maybe is like because of ignoring for a long time the problems that the social structure itself in Europe was suffering. They suffered of Islamophobia. We all know the problems in France, in Paris, between the city and the suburbs, between the Northern African and who are migrant to France and French themselves. I don't want to give a lot of examples about Germany because Germany is is out of all this context because they have a lot of other problems like Asia problem. They want to fill gaps. So they are willing to take a lot of refugees more than anyone else. But it's the question about the rest of Europe. And the other thing is there is kind of misunderstanding of the current conflict that if we are receiving refugees, so maybe there will be one of them, like a tourist from ISIS or Jabhat al-Nusra or whatever, he will bomb somewhere. Believe me, these days, ISIS or Jabhat al-Nusra or any Qaeda militia do not need to recruit anyone. This is this ideology and culture, Europeans and the US could not until now find the right way to fight. To the extent that someone will stab 10 or 15 ones in a mall and without any contact maybe with ISIS or with Jabhat al-Nusra just because the social media and he was sympathized with ISIS. So I mean what I want to brief and there is fundamental problems in the policies of the Europeans and the US towards the Middle East. And there is a misunderstanding to their culture that did not allow them to make right decisions to prevent this crisis. From, like, I remember, I will tell you this story. In 2013, I was invited to the United Nations to speak in front of about 65 missions from around the world about the situation. I am originally from Yarmouk camp in Syria and in Damascus, about the starvation and all this story. So I was telling that time that the Syrian population is about 23 million people. And now after two years of the crisis, half of them either killed or arrested or fled of the country. Let's just imagine that this, and about 40% of the country was destroyed. Let's just imagine that this crisis will last another 3 years. It means that the rest of the country will be destroyed. The rest of the Syrian population will be either fleeing or being killed or arrested. I mean, there will be, we should find other policies to this situation. At that time, the European Union policy was the war, the military intervention, and they did not even did this intervention. After my panel, I was hit by a lot of and attacked by most of the European missions because I was calling for a political solution in Syria. Now they are trying to catch a political solution and they cannot.
There are so many ways you can answer the question you've asked. Because the issue is very complicated. But I'm just going to make, I guess, 2 points. First, I think our perception of, or not our perception, citizens' perception of the other, the strange other, you know, those perceptions have shifted from one moment in history to the other. In the 19th century, it was, you know, it was in large measure the Irish. You know, people who you know, a perception that these people who are coming in are so different. Can't, in Minneapolis in the mid-20th century, it was Jews. A writer for the New Yorker called the town that I live in, the anti-Semitism capital of America. And this notion that these people who are coming in are so different that they can't possibly assimilate, they can't possibly, and also that somehow they threaten our way of life. And I think we've experienced that and continue to experience that in waves of our history. And it's a perceptual issue that we have to address, from one generation to the next. There, I would distinguish that from what I regard as real policy and program challenges with respect to who we bring in and how we bring them in, and those are real issues. For example, during the 70s and 80s and 90s, we were bringing in, the United States was bringing in as refugees large numbers of Soviet Jews, large numbers of Indochinese or Vietnamese refugees. So the programs were very large, so there were economies of scale. There were communities in the United States who were prepared to receive these groups. And so the adjustment process was a relatively smooth one, right? During the last decade or so, we as a government made a decision that our refugee resettlement program should be more responsive to real needs around the world, and therefore we increased the number of refugees we resettle from Africa, from parts of Asia. And it created some challenges where there are smaller numbers of individuals who are coming from each particular place. They don't have networks of support in the United States. And the cultural differences may generally be very significant. A Buddhist Karen refugee from, a Muslim Karen refugee from Burma who comes in, who not only can't write in English, but can't write in their native language, well, there are some challenges there that we're going to have to deal with. I would make a distinction, and we are, and our government has done that in the past decade. So I make a distinction between the us and other perceptual issues and the real challenges when we're talking about a comprehensive program to resettle people. But my parting shot on this will be, I was very pleased about the community that I live in Minneapolis, St. Paul. So I went swimming a couple of weeks ago in a new, one, I think the only naturally filtered swimming pool in the country, I'm told. And it's called the Webber Pool in North Minneapolis, an area of Minneapolis, a very African-American community, a large African-American community, put in that community purposefully. And I'm walking by the swim board, the board which says what is appropriate swimwear apparel, right? And there's the swim trunks and this and that and the other. And then there's a picture of a woman in a burkini, right? And I thought to myself, I ought to take a picture of this and send it to Sarkozy in France. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of a non-issue here. In fact, I did take a picture and I posted it on Facebook. So I think that I tend to look at these issues really as in terms of a glass half full rather than a glass half empty.
Thanks, Eric. Appreciate it. Did you want to add anything, Catherine?
I think there is not one of the difficulties of the so-called crisis is that there is no real European policy of asylum. Each country wants to decide to whom it will grant the refugee status due to the public opinion, which is different from one country to another towards these newcomers, but also due to the diplomacy of each European country. We have not the same neighbors. We have not the same enemies, we have not the same friends according to the various European countries. And inside the accepting or not the refugees, there is a part of diplomacy which is expressed towards this country. We don't give so many asylum statuses to countries with which we are making trade, with which we have agreements about some decision at the UN Assembly and so on. We want to find support from these countries, and in that case we will not give so many asylum statuses. And also when we consider that there is a possibility of so-called migration risk, we will not give so many refugee statuses. For example, during the Algerian crisis, for an Algerian asking asylum to France was much more difficult than asking to Portugal, because France thought if there is we give the status to someone, many will try to enter in this door. So for each country, there is a different approach to the refugee crisis for a lot of nationalities, for the Sri Lanka, for Haiti, for Algeria, for and Europe is very weak, very weak. For example, in France, we have the Calais. We did not speak about Calais. In France, we speak every day about Calais. Calais is a slum for 6,000 people living outside without a roof on their head. And why Calais? Because UK, it is their right, did not accept to sign the Schengen Agreement. So there is no freedom of circulation between other European countries and Ireland and UK. So France is at the border of the sea with, and so there are not other Calais in Europe, but Europe could say, we have to solve the question, and Europe says nothing. says you have to have some agreements and so on, and so no solution, for example. So Europe is very weak. When Mr. Juncker said we have to accept the resettlement of 160,000 people, some countries said no, other yes, other perhaps, and so on. And now the Eastern European countries are saying we will not accept because it is not a compulsory treaty. Mm-hmm. It was just a proposal which became compulsory for us. We don't accept that, and so we are not inside. So there are a lot of problems due to the lack of European solidarity, European consciousness of being together in the implementation of the migration and asylum policy.
Thank you, Kathy. At this point, we have a few minutes left over for questions from the audience, and I'll start right here. You're ready to go. That hand was up before I even started.
Thanks. Trudy Rubin from the Philadelphia Inquirer. Hi, Eric. you have all raised the political factors that make it so difficult to deal with this question. And in reality, we all know that we are sitting here at a political time where every positive proposal faces almost overwhelming political odds. We all know that it is possible there will be a president elected in this country who would reverse, if he could, and he might have the possibility to do so if the Congress would be heavily Republican, would reverse whatever policy we have now, which is already very minimal in terms of taking Syrian refugees. We have Angela Merkel in trouble. We have the European countries, as you spoke of. So how does one do contingency planning in this case? And when we look at a Syria where there is no solution on the horizon, so I'd like to ask that broad question. I would like to ask Nidal, does anyone really think in this little bit of territory where the Turks have inserted troops that you could conceivably have a safe haven for lots of Syrian refugees? It seems to me it's an impossibility from the get-go. And I'd also like to ask Kathleen, will the Turkish deal hold? Because if you would open the door to visas for all Turks, with what Erdogan is doing to the Kurds right now, you could imagine a new influx of legal refugees who would all come in on legal visas.
Thank you. Maybe Nidal and then Kathleen.
Actually, what the Turks are doing now would, to be honest with you, yes. This area will be a safe zone for few hundreds, thousands of Syrians who have nowhere else to go, because like there's about 5 million Syrian refugees around the world, but there is also about 6 million internally displaced. And internally displaced because of two things. Because the war, the bombing, shelling, and the second thing, because of the demographical changes inside Syria, where whenever you want to find a solution or an agreement between the government and the opposition, the government proposes that, okay, we'll open for you a safe passage. So they open, so they evacuate whole areas. So, which is about, until now, about 500,000 to 600,000 Syrians lost their houses forever. Mm-hmm. And other people are being resettled, like from Iran, from Hezbollah, are being resettled in their houses. So, I mean, where will you go with all these people? They have nowhere else to go, even inside Syria. So, even if this Turkish solution is a very hard solution for us as Syrians, we would accept it just to save some lives. Would it be sustainable? It will depend on the pizza vodka agreement between Russia and America, to be honest with you. It's not, no one can guess what will happen today.
Mm-hmm. Kathleen, what's your take? Will it hold?
I think the EU-Turkey deal will hold for a while. I think certainly until after the German election. and I think it might hold farther than that. The costs to Turkey are not great. Syrian refugees inside Turkey are not a big political controversy. It's remarkable, partly because they've been President Erdogan's cause, and President Erdogan is extremely popular. And he says to Syrians, these are our brothers, we have to help them, we may benefit from their presence here. And people are, you know, there have been clashes along the border with some, you know, the Turkish citizens, but remarkably little. And they've opened the schools to, you know, to Syrian kids and the hospitals and the labor market now. So it's pretty remarkable. And it's not hugely controversial. I mean, there is no backlash in Turkey to speak of. So Turkey doesn't have a reason to let it go. The Europeans don't at the moment, although visa-free travel may indeed be the sticking point. But I don't think the prospects of a huge wave of Kurdish refugees are very great at this point.
Thanks, Kathleen. Do you already have here's a microphone coming for you.
You've talked very eloquently about the problems and the potential solutions related to the refugee crisis. I'm not sure I fully understand your points of view related to the threat to democracy per se. I understand the perception of the ideology that may, the political ideology that may come to power in European countries and indeed our own country, and how that might affect dealing with the refugee crisis. But my question to you is, do you really see a threat to democracy based upon those issues?
Well, Lebanon is 5 million population country without a president since 2 or 3 years now, okay? And they are hosting about 2 million Syrian refugees and 400,000 Palestinian refugees. In total, there are 2,500,000 refugees. And add to them the Iraqis and Afghanis who fled from Syria to Lebanon. In total, half of the population in Lebanon is like refugees. Okay, and they are not threatening Lebanon at all until now. Europe, how much is the population of Europe? It's about 200, 300 million?
500.
Okay. And until now, they are discussing receiving 1,200,000 refugees and from around the world. What kind of changes if you just make a small percentage for, it will be like maybe for each 5,000 citizen, there will be one refugee. So I mean in the population sense, no, they will not change. And I don't think that there will be any danger on the democracy of Europe, but there is a question, and a very big question these days, about should we in this world keep going on human rights policies, our human rights system policies a broken one, or should we do reforms for this policy? Thank you.
Excellent. I think, Eric, you were chomping at the bit.
Yeah, it depends on how you define democracy. If you define democracy as the periodic holding of elections, we're good. But we're not going to stop having elections in Europe and the United States, but that's a pretty flimsy definition of democracy, isn't it? I mean, I think we see a lot of troubling signs about. I'm trying to remember the article. I think it was Fareed Zakaria wrote in Foreign Affairs on illiberal democracy. When political leaders are prepared to make attacks on the rights of minorities, when they're prepared to impose restrictions on minorities in the political system, when they're promoting a perception of us and the other within populations that are part of the domestic constituency, when there's tolerance for acts of vigilantism and violence, when there's the tolerance for hate groups that spew a violence, you know, then you have the undermining of democracy, and you absolutely see signs of that kind of thing going on in the Western world today, and that should be extremely troubling, because that does reflect an erosion of democracy.
You're right to say what are we talking about here when we're talking about threats to democracy. But I think what we're seeing is not really a threat to democracy, which after all Aristotle thought was a degenerate form of government, but a threat to Enlightenment values, for sure. And the European Union sort of embodies Enlightenment values in many ways, and it's just not catching on, you know. So you have the sort of democratic deficit of the European Union running up against democratic activism from the right in Europe, and with the European Court of Human Rights as sort of the only bulwark against some of these illiberal decisions. It's very troubling. I think it's a threat to those values. I think it's a real threat to the European Union, which was talking about suspending the membership of Hungary. So Britain is left, Hungary's getting sort of kicked out, and that's very sobering, I think.
Catherine, you want to have the final say on this, I think, key question?
Very important decisions have been taken in Europe, like death penalty in all European countries, without consulting the population. And I think it was good, because in Europe now we are not speaking about democracy, we are speaking about the rise of populism. If we would organize a referendum like does Switzerland about accepting refugees, there would be a no. So it would be democracy, but we democracy is common good. And so I don't think that the fear of those who fear, which is now the answer of most European governments towards the welcome of refugees, is not really corresponding to the ideals of democracy, like they were defined here and in European countries in the 18th century. We have to come back to the fundamentals, to human rights, to the law to be accepted and to be implemented. And now we are not here. We are in a gap. There is a real gap between the values for which Europe has been built and the political trend in which most European countries are going in this period of crisis.
I just have to offer a word of, dissent, not from what you said, but on this question of what is, you know, I think democracy, I think democracy includes the rights of minorities, the right individual rights. Democracy doesn't exist if you don't have an environment in which people are free to express their views and articulate their positions without fear of reprisal. All of that is within the definition of democracy, and so. To my mind, There are, in our history, in this century, no, in the last century, we've got a lot of examples of political leaders who would have received majority vote within their overwhelming majority endorsement of their political leadership, but by no definition of which I'm aware would they be classified as Democrats. And so I don't want to, you know, for me, the definition of democracy includes all of those things.
And for democracy to work, I think it also demands a lot of the demos, of the citizenry, of the folks to be able to be, and in some ways that begs the question of the role of mass mediation in being able to make sure we have an educated citizenry that knows the issues and can address them accurately and effectively. I want to thank you all for, I know it wasn't too many questions, but for a couple of questions from you. And please join me in thanking our panelists. Thank you all. And before the panelists go, before you leave, I want to invite up two of my colleagues, Devesh Kapoor and Jeannie Birch, to give you a sense of the larger context for the kinds of questions that we're trying to address today and tomorrow, and that the Perry World House is organized to grapple with.
Thank you very much. This has been the most exciting morning. We've had two absolutely stunning panels that are inaugurating the work of the Perry World House. We first talked about technology and security, and we heard that particularly with the idea of security, there are four major things we have to think about: microbes, cybersecurity, individuals, and carbon. When we think microbes, let's think about urbanization. Let's think about where those microbes are in cities. What are we going to do about Zika? When we think about cybersecurity, let's think about cities. What's going to happen with if the electrical grid goes down? Can you imagine how paralyzed a city would be? Let's think about individuals. We've just heard about refugees, some 65 million refugees, or maybe 244 refugees and migrants, million migrants. Where are they? Many, the majority, are located in cities. Think of other individuals, youth. There are 600 million youth that are emerging looking for jobs worldwide. And do you know how many jobs we anticipate having? 200 million. How are we going to accommodate those people in our cities? This is why I believe that our leader, Bill Burke White, has chosen as the second theme for Perry World House the theme entitled Global Shifts, Urbanization, Migration, and Demography. In the next few years, we're going to see the urban population doubling, going to 2.5 billion. What does this mean? This means that certain places of the world, namely Asia, Africa, and indeed here in the United States, places will need to build the equivalent of a city of a million every week for the next 40 years. A city of a million every week for the next 40 years. This is indeed a huge global issue. And Penn is very well situated to address many of the challenges that I mentioned before and many more that we know about. We're so well positioned because we have 12 schools with scholars who are addressing these things, whether they be health, education, how to make jobs and employment, whether we're dealing with the design of the cities, historic preservation, transportation, the drones we heard about. Not only are they used for military use, but they're also used to go into buildings to see what's happened and how we manage a disaster where you can't send people in, but you can send a drone in to see what we need to do. At any rate, we are really well positioned. And I represent the Penn Institute for Urban Research, which is another university-wide institution that was started in 2004. And I can't tell you how happy we are to partner with Perry World House on this theme of global shifts, urbanization, and migration. One part of this theme will deal with a very important event that is going to happen next month, and that is the convening of Habitat 3, the once every 20-year UN, all UN conference to deal with cities. And we've been extremely involved already with Perry World House on this activity. We've been involved in the preparations for it. We were asked by the U.S. Department of State and U.S. Department of HUD to hold one of five regional conferences to talk about the implications of urbanization, global agreements on urbanization here in the United States. We've created something called Global Urban Commons, which is an interactive directory of more than 1,000 organizations, 58,000 networks, who are engaged in thinking about urbanization and how they can contribute to what we want to have sustainable urban development. On October 4th, we will be bringing journalists here to help people here at Penn understand how they can participate in this conference, because they're not going to Quito, but they certainly can participate in what's going on. And in fact, we're sending our own delegation to the Habitat, including Bill, including Mark Allen Hughes from the Energy People, including David Gouverneur from Landscape Architecture, myself, City Planning. You can see the variety of disciplines that we are bringing to address these issues. And post-Habitat, in December, we'll be bringing the Deputy Executive Director of UN Habitat here to help us think what we can do going forward in the post-Habitat 3 world. And lastly, in April, we'll be working throughout the university to create a major conference on the issues of urbanization. So this is just the beginning of our partnership. We're thrilled, and we hope you are thrilled, that we will be confronting these issues, because if we understand our cities, we can understand the world. Thank you.
I'm really honored to be here sort of at the inaugural of Perry World House. It's a real testimony to Bill Burke-White and his colleagues in making this happen. I think as our panelists have discussed, and Jeannie has indicated sort of in her remarks, so urbanization and migration are two major global shifts that are occurring around the world. And at Penn, we have a range of faculty and centers that are working on migration-related issues, both internal and international, especially in Latin America, Africa, and the two giants, China and India. The Population Center here is a world leader in understanding population dynamics. While the demography may not be the destiny, the demographic changes around the world are a major driver behind this burgeoning urbanization and migration. But migration is not just caused by changes in populations. It has also large consequences in fertility, as some of our colleagues are working on, especially in places like Mexico. Migration has major political consequences, which is what we've been discussing, and some of my colleagues in political science and at the Hannenberg School have been looking at some of these issues, which I think something that was perhaps overlooked in our earlier discussion, which is the economics of anxieties post-2007-8, which have been part of the way in which both in the US and in Europe there are great anxieties about labor flows in an era of much greater economic uncertainty. Now, while low-income countries and conflict are driving one type of migration, there are other types of migration that are occurring, which are being driven because some countries are actually becoming are becoming very wealthy. This year, the U.S. will host about 1 million international students. And international student flows are actually being shaped because of very rapidly rising incomes in countries like China and India. And in fact, by 2020, China itself will be the second largest destination of international students, way overtaking the U.K. So there are large population dynamics and migrations. A big part is this story of refugees, but there are big parts that are part of skill migrations, student flows, and that are part of the sort of research agenda of the center which I head, which is the Center like for the advanced study of sort of India, as well as the Center for Contemporary China, because these two giants, just the sheer rates of economic growth and the very large populations, are going to be a big part of the migration dynamics, especially unfolding around sort of Asia. Finally, sort of among the activities related to migration, which we'll be hosting at Perry World House, I'll just highlight two. One, Perry World House will be hosting Mr. Arafat Jamal, who's the head of the Interagency Service of UNHCR, and he'll be leading efforts to address some of the very complex issues that were raised by our panelists. And we're also planning a major conference under the theme of, you know, global shifts in focus on migration and inequality, because besides the economic sort of anxieties, the much greater sort of inequality that is emerging in the US and in Europe is also, I think, a big part of the anxieties behind migration. So we are all looking forward to a great inaugural year. Thank you.
So I want to just thank Jeannie and Devesh for their extraordinary faculty leadership around our Global Shifts theme and our partnerships with the institutes they each run. I also want to thank Dean Jackson for his moderation of the panel and our wonderful panelists who have really helped us enlighten and think through the challenges facing Europe and facing migrants and refugees around the world today. It is now my opportunity to invite you to join us for lunch. But before doing that, I want to say a couple of words about where it is in the next hour. Behind you is our student lounge, which has been converted into a lunch space for us, and there's a wonderful lunch spread. But I'd encourage you to use the next hour after you get your lunch or before to explore this extraordinary building, and particularly to explore the art for which I have to thank Lisa and Richard Perry. It is art that provokes us, that challenges us, that speaks to the themes of both urbanization and migration, as well as broader global political challenges and the global order. There is a sheet out by the reception that will share with you some of the works. We invite you upstairs to see more art. I'd also invite you to grab one of the lovely Perry World House Moleskine notebooks and pens to take notes from this event. They're there for you. And then encourage you to join us again at 1:30 when we will have what I'm sure is going to be both a fascinating and provocative conversation about the role of religion in global politics. I hope to see you back then. And in the meantime, enjoy the food, the company, and the extraordinary art. Thank you.